On behalf of the Henry Steele Commager Lecture Series Committee, and on behalf of the entire GCC community, it is my pleasure to introduce a true local hero, Bill Newman.
Well, my thanks to President Pura and Professor and Attorney Buzz Eisenberg and the committee and to all of you for the real honor of allowing me to make this address today. I'd like to start with a couple confessions, if I might. The Civil Liberties Minute, contrary to its title, is actually 90 seconds. And the reason for that, in part, is because if I say, "Can I have a minute of your time?" I think you'll say, "Sure." And if I say, "Can I have 90 seconds?" you go, "No, no, no, that's kind of a long time. I'm not sure about that." The other piece is this, that when I was notified of this honor, notwithstanding Professor Eisenberg's gracious and accolade-laden introduction, I thought it might be a mistake. And so I Googled myself, and what I found is that there are a lot of William Newmans in the world, some of them very accomplished, and I thought maybe they had simply emailed the wrong one. And the reason for that is that you could do this introduction very differently. You could say, okay, here's Newman. He has a talk show on radio on an AM station in a small rural market, not during prime time or drive time, where his co-host is a guy named after a card game, Monty Belmonte. And so I thought, well, maybe it's not really a mistake. Maybe this is a reflection of GCC basically feeling sorry for me. And this is the first year of the Henry Steele Commager Pity Award. Henry Steele Commager was a great American historian, as Buzz noted. He wrote some 40 books, some 700 essays and reviews. His opinions mattered. He held sway in the media and in public consciousness as a leading advocate against abuse of governmental power. He stood as a stalwart against McCarthyism. He was a leading opponent of the Vietnam War. A brilliant professor and teacher at NYU in Columbia, he then taught for some 36 years at Amherst College. To be mentioned in the same sentence or paragraph or on the same page with Henry Steele Commager is an honor. And as I've pointed out, perhaps in this instance, undeserved and perhaps misplaced, but an honor. And since we're all here, I would like to spend some time trying to share with you what I have learned about media, and particularly local media, and our relationship to it. 2 weeks ago, Christopher, generally known as Monty Belmonte, who is the face and voice of an AM, of an FM, mostly, though hardly exclusively, music, idiosyncratic and well-loved radio station, pushed a shopping cart, souped up by students at Smith Vocational High School, from Northampton, through Amherst, and then north to Greenfield, a 26-mile trek. Monty's March, as it's called, has become a yearly event and a significant fundraiser for the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts. This year, Congressman Jim McGovern, who has provided the leadership in the Congress in the fight against hunger and against food insecurity, walked the entire marathon distance with Monty. 93.9 The River followed Monty's march live, on and off, obviously, for 12 hours, and on WHMP, we devoted a significant part of my show to the march, and the station provided updates throughout the day. Both stations shamelessly importuned our listeners. Congressman McGovern was enormously impressed with the response of the community for funds. He was even more impressed with the sense of community itself. This project, Monty's March, that day raised some $56,000 for the food bank. That $56,000, because of the purchasing power of the food bank, yields over $500,000 of food for families who are our friends and neighbors and co-workers. Many of the families who depend on the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts and their survival centers and the food pantries that it serves have adults working two or three jobs. those adults have a choice at the end of a pay period to buy food or to pay for heat or to buy medicine because they can't afford all of them and so are faced with a Hobson's choice. Many communities, I believe, care about their members and take care of each other, but I suspect few, as was Congressman McGovern's observation, few organize themselves in the way that we do, or attempt efforts like Monty's March. Now, part of the reason is that Monty Belmonte can't be replicated. But another part of what allows us to organize ourselves and our social, economic, creative, artistic, social, and philanthropic endeavors is a vibrant and involved social media, local newspapers, magazines, and radio stations. That sense of community and shared effort, and the ability of local media to help galvanize us for our better angels, manifests itself in Monty's March. The idea was Monty's. The response is a testament to and a reflection of community. At the risk of sounding naive and Pollyannish, I think one reason that the community coalesces around efforts like these is because we genuinely talk to and rarely, although sometimes, we rarely demonize each other. To be sure, we become apoplectic and often feel adamant about the righteousness of our causes and our candidates, but at the end of the day, our governance, our local institutions, in contrast to the United States Congress, most of the time work pretty well. Part of the foundation of this paradigm of community participation, and you really need not go any further than what will soon happen in the Valley Gives campaign, which last year raised in one day $1 million for local social justice and philanthropic groups and NGOs, and this year is expected to raise $2 million that day. I think that lies in part due to the number of institutions of learning that we have here in the Valley, including, of course, Greenfield Community College. Another cornerstone of that paradigm is our history, from Daniel Shea's rebellion to Sojourner Truth in Northampton and Amherst being a stop on the Underground Railroad. A third foundational piece is the natural beauty of this valley and its attraction to artists and writers and creative souls of all stripes. And as a corollary to that, but deserving of its own mention, is the importance of the richness of the soil and our connection to agriculture and the earth and the beauty and presence of the longest river in New England. These two connect us to this place. On Monty's and my show, we have a number of regular segments. The only one we had dreamt up before we actually started broadcasting was the Fish Wrap. The Fish Wrap, today's newspaper's tomorrow's Fish Wrap. It's commentary not only on the substance of the news, but our critique on how the news is presented. The Fish Wrap allows us to turn a kaleidoscope on the picture of news and events portrayed by traditional media. For our show on the day of Christmas Eve 3 years ago, I invited just retired First Church's minister, Peter Ives, and Congregation B'nai Israel's Rabbi Justin David to be our guests. I didn't really know what would happen or what they would say, and as a practical matter, I actually never do. If you pre-interview people before the show, as we say, you lose the magic. So I almost never pre-interview a guest. I got a request yesterday or this morning for a guest who's gonna come on, I think next week, and the agent wanted to know what questions I would ask. And I will politely write back and say, actually, you don't get those. Doesn't prevent them from asking, it just prevents them from getting. The promo that I cut for that show, for Christmas Eve, said this. Could we do this every day? We promo the show for the morning and the day before and said, so, A reverend and a rabbi walk into a radio station on Christmas Eve where lots of people were wearing elves costumes and hats and Santa costumes, which is true. And the reverend says to the rabbi, well, actually, we don't know what the reverend is going to say to the rabbi, but we'll find out tomorrow at 9 o'clock, this morning at 9 o'clock. And it turned out that was really quite a remarkable show with the reverend and the rabbi. You could hear it. You could feel it. You could feel their own faith and their goodwill. And the reverend and the rabbi became a regular segment on the show. Similarly, 3 years ago for the celebration of Martin Luther King Day, I had four African Americans, men and women, on the program, including Michael Ford, the former dean at UMass, and then for many years the dean of students at Hampshire College, Northampton High School teacher and coach Ray Harp, Professor Carly Tartikoff, and the Reverend Dr. Jacqueline Smith Crooks. And I started that show by posing a question that made me really nervous and uncomfortable. I prefaced it by saying, I've known some of you a long time. Michael and Mary Ford used to be my neighbors. But I'm chagrined and a little embarrassed to say on the air that I've never asked you the question I'm about to ask, which is this: what's it like to be black in the valley? And to a person, they thanked me for asking that question because they say race is such a charged and difficult topic that even people they know, they're saying to me, we know well, steer away from it. They said on the air that we'd really like to answer that question because it's so rarely asked. And after that show, we thought we should continue the conversation, and Black in the Valley since then has been a regular segment. Over time, we've developed other segments as well, including one of my favorites, professor and astronomer Salman Hamid. He's a professor at Hampshire College in the Five College Consortium. He's an astronomer. We call his segment The Ridiculously Large and Largely Ridiculous Universe with Professor Salman Hamid. We have a segment with renowned children's book author Jane Yolen, her daughter Heidi Stemple, also a renowned children's book author, and we call that Once Upon a Time. We have Political Gold with Josh Silver, Josh being the founder of United Republic and the Free Press before that. We have a segment called Your State You with Professor Max Page. Max is an art historian, a professor at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And we talk about a lot of issues regarding higher education, including the issues that are presented at and for community colleges. Other segment includes a recent one we've added with Mount Holyoke College President Lynn Pascarella, whose doctorate is in philosophy and is a renowned medical ethicist. So we talked to her about morals and ethics. But because she's also this diehard Red Sox fan, we get her opinions on how the Sox are doing. Another segment we've added focuses on forensics. It's with attorney Harry Miles, and we call it NCIS, Northampton Criminal Investigative Service. One of my favorites is with Peter Blanchett, the founder and director of the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra, and another we call NPR. Northampton Poetry Radio with our own poet laureate, Rich Michelson. So we do that, and we bring on a lot of poets and writers to the show. We conclude every week with a segment that's called Inside Out, What to Do Inside and Out in the Valley this weekend, and our regular guests and our guest hosts for that include artist Betsy Stone, Scott Cohen, the longtime sports commentator and author, and often A.J. LaFleur, who off the air we like to call Mountain Man or Mr. Goat, A.J. being the owner of the Mountain Goat. Now, collectively, and even collectively, these individuals cannot paint the entire panoramic of the valley. But they certainly represent and speak to significant parts of the mosaic of this place we call home. Our regular segments, I think, showcase many voices and the intelligence and humanity and perspective of those individuals. I don't think that the popularity of those individual segments reflects parochialism, although undeniably there's some of that. Rather, I believe that what is reflected there is a genuine interest in our collective experience of life in the valley. I conduct what, for a moment, I will, for convenience sake, call interviews, a lot of interviews on the show, with politicians and newsmakers and authors, many authors. But we also have on high school kids. If you listen to today's program, we had a number of youth from the LGBTQ community. There is in Greenfield today a remembrance for transgender people and transgender youth who have died. There was such a remembrance in Northampton yesterday. And these young people are amazing, and they are amazing guests. Yesterday we had on the show the thespians from Northampton High School who are putting on the play Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, which was great for me because when I was forced to look at this play in high school, I didn't have a clue what it was about. But now that I've had these high school students on the show, I kind of understand it, for which I'm grateful. We've had on the show the high school band from SciTech. We've had on the show recently a 7-year-old girl whose name is Lavery Greenfield. Lavery goes to the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts with her mom, who volunteers there. And Lavery says, I want to do something, I want to help. She's 7 years old, she's this high. She can't really go and bring the food down from the shelf. That's not going to work. It's just not. So there didn't seem to be much for Lavery to do. And in response, Lavery, age 7, organized, and I'm not making this up, organized a peanut butter and jelly jar drive at the Hatfield Elementary School. And we had 7-year-old Lavery on as a guest, and the interview with her was as powerful and meaningful and funny as almost anyone we've done. I should mention, I did speak to Monty, tell him that we had a 7-year-old kid coming on the show, and you have kids about this age, Monty, so you know, feel free to really participate in this conversation. And Monty says, fine, no problem. So Monty loves talking to kids, he really does, he's a great teacher. And so Monty says something like, so Lavery, you must really like peanut butter and jelly. And Lavery says, actually, I don't. And then he says, well, you must, you don't? And I looked over and said, thanks, Monty. Really, really great way to get that conversation started. The question is, what do these pieces of radio amount to? What effect, if any, can we attribute to these relatively transient words broadcast over the airwaves and on the internet? Do they make any difference? And if so, how? And why? My thought is, my hope is, that Monty and our guests and our segment hosts are building community or are providing a forum and a platform on which others can build community. And by building community, I don't mean contributing to the balkanization of information and news, which I consider dangerous and the antithesis of what, with luck, we are contributing to. Viewers and listeners go to Fox News because it reinforces a worldview that those listeners and viewers already hold, and many adamantly so. Now, the same can be said for MSNBC, although the latter, in my judgment, is more dedicated to facts, more dedicated to separating commentary from the news, and way more apt to criticize their side of the political spectrum than Fox News is, which is a cheerleading section almost invariably. Now, going to those news and commentary sources with which we're comfortable is understandable. We prefer, we are less challenged, it makes us less anxious to hear news and commentary that is consistent with, consonant with, our belief systems. We go to, we tune in, we click on, we visit places where we're comfortable. As Paul Simon said, a man hears what he wants to hear, and he disregards the rest. All commentators, whether on the right, which predominates the airwaves, including Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, and Bill O'Reilly, as well as those nearer the nebulous political center or left, or somewhere else that's harder to define or pigeonhole, they deal with, many of the same contemporary issues. They frame them differently, but they're the same issues: climate change, disasters, man-made and natural, terrorism, civil rights, democracy, hunger, international crises, employment, depletion of natural resources, domestic politics, political races, medical insurance, economic policy, the deficit, war, peace, and nuclear threats, among others. The list of topics is, unfortunately, more impressive than the coverage, because the coverage afforded by the major networks is, everyone knows, superficial at best. I once saw the copy of a nightly newscast put on the page, the front page of a newspaper. I believe it was the New York Times. All the words spoken, not all the images, but all the words spoken in a nightly half-hour newscast, which of course has about 21 or 22 minutes of actual content and the rest is ads. That content took up less than one-third of a page of a newspaper. And that is the place, television is the place, where most people, I'm sad to say, get their news. Local media, in contrast to national media, provides opportunities that national media cannot avail itself of. We can do something. The Recorder, the Gazette, the Republican, the magazines, including Pioneer Magazine, the radio stations, and including the low-power Valley Free Radio, WXOJ, all of these media instruments of communication, these distributors of news, give us opportunities to speak and to listen that is not made available by some feed from a central news source. It allows us, it provides the opportunity to literally bring home national and international issues and highlight how they affect us, how these stories are relevant to our lives and our values and our concerns and our politics. This is an extraordinary opportunity to build a foundation of engagement in local and national and international affairs. Tip O'Neill used to say that all politics is local, and I think that's right. It at least starts locally because you can feel it, you can hear it, you can sense it, and it matters immediately to you today, this week, this month. And from there, I think we help bring under some understanding to the issues that confront us on both a national and international level. I acknowledge, and I'm grateful for the fact, that we live, generally speaking, in a relatively liberal community. And liberals love process. Marshall McLuhan, some of my best friends are liberals, right? Marshall McLuhan famously said that the medium is the message, and the manner of presentation is the medium, the process by which content is presented, and that matters a lot. I prepare for the discussions that I have with guests on the show and with the guest hosts as well. I've read the author's book, or at least a lot of it. I've researched the candidate's position. I read yesterday's Supreme Court decision, so I can talk about it. But I almost never have more than two or three at most questions, or even just areas or phrases that I want to talk to the guest about. And the reason for that is that I actually have no intention of conducting an interview. I have all the intention in the world of having a conversation, and it's different. There's a cost. Some things go unasked, some things go unsaid. But that cost, for me, is more than worth it. The intentionality here is to have a conversation, because that conversation, I hope, allows people to hear and think for themselves. What I don't want to do is talk at people. And although cacophony and disputatious opinion sometimes can make great radio, it also can make us hear and appreciate each other and ourselves. Monologues tend to be solipsistic and boring, whereas genuine dialogue, even if it's disputatious, allows us to come to a greater understanding of who we are and who we aren't, and what we share and what we don't. On the radio show, I ask questions I want to know the answer to. I have this idea that if I'm involved in the conversation and interested in it, a listener, even a casual passerby on the radio dial, might want to stop and eavesdrop on it. There is a phrase I believe that NPR first coined for fun drives, driveway moments. You're listening to the radio while driving, you pull into your driveway, but instead of turning off the car and going inside, you sit in the driveway and listen. We strive for those. Some years ago, Ira Glasser, the then longtime executive director of the American Civil Liberties Union, and by the way, not a lawyer, said that all civil liberties cases make for strange bedfellows. And then Glasser went on to say, continuing the metaphor of strange bedfellows, that the ACLU as an organization should readily admit that we are utterly promiscuous. Now, we have bedfellows from the left, and more often on the left, I think, because that's who the government targets more often. But many times, we're on the side of conservatives, people on the right. As the late muckraking journalist Nat Hentoff put it so succinctly as the title of his book, a collection of his columns, "Free Speech for Me, But Not for Thee, How the American Left and Right Relentlessly Censor Each Other." Let me give an example from a radio show on how we tried to defy that ignoble history. Reverend Paul Gustine is the longtime pastor of the Evangelical and Fundamentalist Bible Baptist Church in Northampton. He is, I think it's fair to say, a Tea Party supporter. Reverend Gustine believes in the literal word of the Bible. I'm pretty convinced he's convinced that unless something dramatically different happens that allows me to find salvation before I die, which I've assured him won't happen, my skeptical self is condemned to an eternity in a really unpleasant place. And that for my temporal journey here on earth, my misguided politics have taken me down an almost equally hellish path. But I like Paul Gustine. I'm not saying we're going to be hanging out and going to Red Sox games and drinking beer together, but I really like him as a guest on the show. I completely respect his right to his beliefs, and I'm fascinated. I want to understand this belief system that millions and millions of Americans share. I'd bet something else, that notwithstanding we live in different worlds, albeit geographically not that very far away from each other, there are some issues on which we agree. And one of those is the right to be heard. After Reverend Gustine first came on my radio show, we thought perhaps he would never come back. I mean, after all, he had been surrounded by progressive people who, for a variety of reasons, not all in congruent with each other, utterly reject his view of the Bible and what he believes are God's injunctions that lead inexorably to certain political views. And yet Reverend Gustine comes back on the show because, I think, we treat him with respect and he has the opportunity to speak. And for a preacher, what's more important than the opportunity to preach, particularly to those who are not saved and need saving? So he has the opportunity to say what he wants to say. And I have the opportunity to have him state clearly what he believes. It's all good. This is not to say that we have one long kumbaya moment, or that his assertions go unchallenged. That's not true. It's not true at all. It is to say that together we bring into sharper focus and bring into sharp relief the points of disembarkation from each other's belief systems, something that I think is valuable if we are to acknowledge the variety of opinions and beliefs that exist and therefore necessarily have to coexist in our community. Through our guests and our regular segments and our fish wrap, we reflect the community. Sometimes it's best, and sometimes spotlighting its deep flaws, but it is a place for people to share ideas, and at best, a place that allows listeners to put down roots, or more roots. Let's be clear, and I think this is really important, about what we're not doing. This is another confession, perhaps an obvious one. Any commentator must acknowledge it. We're moochers. Unrepentant, unapologetic, inveterate, indeed almost compulsive moochers. We don't make policy decisions or arrest bad guys or innocent ones either for that matter. We don't create the art or write the music. We don't build satellites or explore space. We generally don't write books or histories. We didn't investigate the stories or compose the headlines. We are neither hunters nor gatherers of news, and we are utterly dependent on those who do. Leading to a fair question that I have been skirting in part during this discussion, which is, what in God's name, Newman, do you do? It's actually easier to describe what we don't do than what we do. And while I'm busy circumnavigating that question for just another few moments, we should not lose track of the importance and the necessity of those who do report the news and sometimes die trying to get it. Those who engage in investigative journalism and report the news are people to whom we are and should be indebted and grateful. And we should not, although we cannot delve into this with the time we have today, ignore the unsettled and deeply unsettling question of what economic model will allow real journalism and investigative reporting to exist, much less flourish, in the 21st century. Last week, we were lucky to have as a guest on the show the Pulitzer Prize-winning historian and author Doris Kearns Goodwin. Ms. Goodwin was in the Valley at Mount Holyoke College talking about her new book, The Bully Pulpit, Theodore Roosevelt, William Howard Taft, and the Golden Age of Journalism. In that book and in her talk, she discussed McClure's magazine and how a magazine, presented thoroughly researched investigative journalism, journalism that drove national discussion, policy, politics, and legislation in the progressive era and led to progressive systemic change. Quite an amazing story, the golden age of journalism. Compare that to another recent guest, Nation magazine writer John Nichols, who with his co-author John McChesney have a new book by the title Dollarocracy, How Money and the Media Election Complex is Destroying America. Nichols and McChesney write, quote, on a per capita basis, less than half as much money and time is devoted to journalism today as 25 years ago. Just since 2000, the labor and resources committed by major media to producing the news have dropped by 30%. Those authors assert, in essence, that the independent functioning of the media that the founding fathers envisioned and depended upon are now somewhere between at risk and on life support. That said, it is right to celebrate the democratization, the sharing of opinion on the internet, where anyone can blog and many do. And we should celebrate community television and cable access laws that empower citizens to be television directors and producers and newscasters and commentators and advocates. And likewise, low power community radio stations, as I mentioned, XOJ in Northampton, offer a forum for citizen producers and journalists. These are very useful tools for sharing opinion and information. Cable access provides the transparency in local government. Nothing else does that, and not in that way. But they do not, these media outlets, do not and cannot fulfill the crucial role of actually reporting, of hunting and gathering for those facts and those stories. Nor, in the main, do they claim to. Which brings me to what I think is the crucial function of a social commentator today, acknowledging the resources on which we necessarily rely. Outside of the Washington Post and the New York Times and the occasional Glenn Greenwald writing for The Guardian in the UK, the means of sharing facts as well as opinion and perspective comes down to not the daily media as much as the books that these journalists write. And so I think that one crucial role of the commentator is to share the insights of these authors who are to a major degree the investigative journalists of today. Yesterday we had on the show the best-selling author John Wiseman, whose new book, Countdown, tells a disturbing but extraordinary story of how, if population growth remains unchecked, the Earth as we know it will be destroyed. He is also an optimist. He tells a story about how, instead of having, with no oppressive governmental intervention, a population in the world that comes to a kind of stasis at 6 billion people and not 16 billion people. And the answer is education of women. It's really quite an extraordinary story. It's a story that needs to be told. It is a blueprint for policy matters that we need to seriously look at before it's seriously too late. This conclusion about authors brings me back to the notion of commentary and how to actually conduct commentary. Larry King, Bill Moyers, and Charlie Rose, for example, provide, in my judgment, more social commentary in an hour of asking good questions than a Fox stalwart like Sean Hannity will do in a year of taping and repeating and regurgitating polemics. The creators of the gold standard of commentary show us two essential ingredients of commentary and critique: time and conversation. As pointed out in a recent New York Times article, Dick Cavett and David Frost, for example, generally did not interview guests. Rather, they had conversations with them, and they allowed the conversations to evolve to a point of disclosure. What these models for commentators show is this, and it's a quote from the Times article: when you push or try to take something from a guest, you don't get much. But when you let the conversation breathe, when you let your segments run a little longer, the guests often give great material and insight and disclosures. They give it to you if you let it be their choice. As an interviewer, as a conversationalist, I hope, I ask questions. In this role, I try to remain true to the obligation to point out when the emperor has no clothes and to remain skeptical of official and governmental pronouncements. These conversations, I'm hopeful, encourage civic engagement by helping to create community. It's odd, I think, how that word community is so malleable. If everyone's for it, and I think if we took a poll here who's for community, we'd have virtual unanimity, why is it so special? And why is it so difficult to create? Part of the reason is the word is confusing. Are we talking about a community of, say, shared interests, and is in a community of scholars, or some other type of community that may be separate or separated from yet other communities, even if geographically interspersed? The problem is we think about community definitionally as something in which we restrict membership, as opposed to the potential for inclusivity. In my law practice, my work for the ACLU in particular, as well as on my radio show, whatever success I have had, I owe to the community of people with whom I've worked. This is true for the case of the 17-year-old Saudi whom Buzz Eisenberg and I represented when he was detained in Guantanamo. It's true for the death penalty case we litigated in Georgia. It's true for the community of supporters we had for the Bunny King case here in Greenfield 30 years ago, the first gay custody case in Massachusetts. It's true for the opposition to the Seabrook nuclear plants and with the Clamshell Alliance, who we depended on enormously for our successful opposition to Northeast Utilities' plan to build twin nuclear plants in Montague. And while it's an aphorism with sometimes limited utility that success has many parents and failure is an orphan, the simple truth is that success indeed has many parents. Virtually every significant law case I've been involved with has been a collective effort of lawyers, paralegals, clients, supporters, a community of people with a shared goal of a shared humanity that we were seeking. In my judgment, a commentator needs to be mindful of the adage, he convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. A commentator thus does his best and most useful work, not so much when fashioning an argument that he thinks will persuade people, although the temptation to do that sometimes is overwhelming, but rather the better work is done when we construct a mirror that allows us to see ourselves and allow others to see themselves and say, yes, that's who I want to be, that's what I want to believe, or no, I want to change that. I want to change what I'm looking at. Or I can live with that image, but I don't think my kids can. I'm not saying that this is simple or that it always works, but I do believe it's worth the effort. I sometimes hear almost confessional statements from people who have not heard the show. They tend to be sheepish about this because they want to talk about the show, but they actually haven't heard the show, and they don't want to admit that they haven't heard the show, but they want to talk about what was on it. And so that's, well, how do we put this? Awkward. But for me, those comments are manna from heaven because it means that people are talking and communicating and sharing some assertion or point or perspective that was made and that the program is reaching far beyond the audience, far beyond the audience who are actually hearing it at 9 o'clock or 6 o'clock or downloading the podcast. And that those ideas and the sharing of those ideas, the sharing of a discussion, a delineation of problems and hopes and aspirations, it is part of community because it is a discussion in the community. And I think I should probably confess this as well. It's the conversation that in some ways I most want to have because most of the time we're talking about the place I most care about, which is where I live. What comments like these show me is that we are generating thought and debate, and for a media person, it doesn't get better than that. Which reminds me, this being Bobby Kennedy's birthday, the anniversary of it, of a quote from Robert F. Kennedy, one that I hold dear. He said this, each time a man, today I'm sure he would say a person, stands up for an idea or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope, and crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, those ripples can sweep down the mightiest walls. My hope is that our show and the Civil Liberties Minute and the Gazette column, these presentations create one or more of these ripples, because I hope to participate in the venture of finding solutions to sometimes seeming intractable problems, overcoming the very real problem of us all at times being utterly intractable. There's a synergy between my work as an ACLU attorney and as a radio host and commentator, because the community I hope to help facilitate is a community of questioners and dissenters and optimists who say, as Bobby Kennedy did, "Some people see the world as it is and ask why. I dream of the world as it might be and ask why not." A community that understands, as Henry Steele Commager put it, that America was born of revolt, flourished on dissent, and became great through experimentation. And so at the conclusion of these remarks, I'd like to repeat something that I said at the beginning, and that is to thank you for this recognition for the honor of being able to give this talk today. Henry Steele Commager was a remarkable man, and so I accepted this opportunity, not really for myself, but on behalf of all of us. Thanks very much. Comment, question, thoughts, musings?
I spent about an hour and a half of my car each day on my commute, which is way too long, and as a result, I'm a podcast junkie, and I'm delighted to hear that you have a podcast, so I'll be signing up. But I'm just curious to know if you think there is a difference now that with social media, it is so easy to share, even a snippet, which is relatively easy to do with software, to actually pass around things like a radio podcast. And share. And I suppose you could say the same of print media and so on through or video. But it seems to me that those of us, at least with commutes, it's the radio that we're really consuming there. And I'd be curious to know if you think that the sharing possibilities now that it's more than just, oh, did you hear that on such and such, which we can't replicate? I can rewind and listen again.
Yeah, the notion of various content going viral is really interesting. And you raise that question, what goes viral and why does it do that and why are people interested in this particular snippet and how does that happen? And of course it happens because it's really easy to do it. And I think that's all to the good, except when the snippet that's being passed around is utterly false. It also happens a lot. And was it Mark Twain's adage that the truth barely has a sock on while a lie has gone halfway around the world. And that's still true, and that's still a problem. The interesting question you raise about radio is, what will radio look like in 10 or 15 or 20 years? And is this notion of a terrestrial radio station something that we'll look back and think was quaint? Because there will be different platforms and different ways to make the content available. Sirius satellite radio, of course, being an example of something that may well be the model for future media companies. If I really knew the answer to your question, I'd be a gazillionaire in 20 years because I'd invest today. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
What do you recommend to students who get excited about journalism for those statistics about the quantity of people that get their news from print going way down? What might they aspire to doing with this
question? I think there will be journalists. I think there will be investigative reporters. I think that in this transition period, which is going to be and has been very painful for journalists and aspiring journalism majors, that it's difficult to say, here's the job you will have, here's the kind of place you will work, this is the kind of work you will do. But it is going to happen because the need is greater than ever. There is so much information that the need to be able to siphon out the essence of important stories and to write about them or talk about them or present them or create the video of them in a way that is accessible and makes people understand is greater than ever. There has been a long discussion, and Nichols and McChesney do this in the book, on the proposition that the amount of political advertising in the last presidential election in the swing states was so great, and some say, that it kind of canceled out all the rest, and it was just a lot of noise, and it didn't matter. It actually mattered enormously, and it still matters enormously. And for that journalist who can say, here's what's happening, here's what they're saying, here's why what they're saying is untrue, here's how it's manipulative, and this is why you shouldn't pay the least attention to it, or if you pay attention to it, you should reject it, that's a great story. And people will need to tell those stories. And it is actually the omnipresence of various kinds of communication that makes the ability to distill stories to their essence so very important. There will be that role, there will be that necessity. The economic model that will support it is not yet made itself known.
Patricia.
I'm curious what your thoughts are about the use of internet, blogging, posting, Twittering, all of those things where people can say whatever they want, and yet often it's been used to for young people and older people to be bullied, to be accused of things, to be denigrated, to not be civil. And where does the what protection do people have with this, the freedom to have this kind of medium, but also use it in ways that is very destructive? I just wonder what your thoughts are. Is there any boundary law, legal thing that are going to happen?
I don't think there is an easy answer to that question, and I don't think that there's an easy solution to that. I feel the pain of the people who say, I Googled myself, I did nothing wrong, I'm really a good person, and if you Google me, you find out I'm guilty of, at least in the public's mind, of the following horrible event or circumstance. It's enormously unfair. But there is a model that the ACLU uses, which I think is the saving grace. And the ACLU would say that the answer and the response to bad speech, to denigrating speech, to unfair speech, to racist speech, to hate speech, is good speech and righteous and fair and accurate speech. Because in the end, most of the time, the latter will in fact be the more forceful means of coming to the truth of the matter, which is not to say that people aren't going to be hurt, because they will be. Oh, no, we don't want to end on that depressing note. Someone has a really quick last question so we can do something optimistic? No, huh? Okay, thanks, you've been a great audience.